Come on, Danube. Come on, Danube.
And he's like, come on, guys. Come on. This is in Norway.
Come on, Danube. Come on, Danube.
Come on.
Come on. Come on, Danube.
This is the material, Bella.
Come on, Danube.
Yeah!
It's going quite well.
Yeah.
But I'm a bit nervous. It's my first time and
come! Come!
You know, and I don't really know the outcome of anything, and I have to pass a road, I have to pass a lot of, you know, this is a forest here, but at some point it's a kind of densely populated
area.
Yes, thank you for word. But at some point, because I'm obviously keeping a too fast pace because I just want to get there, I'm open route.
Come down!
So at one point, the matriarch, which is the leader, she doesn't approve of my leadership anymore. She just takes on another route. And then I have to run after them, and then basically I have to fight myself in as if they're the leader again. And, I think I lost them there. Where are you guys? Ah, yeah, there you are. I mean, I didn't plan this stop. They were like, you know, we just stop. There she is, Bella. But the shepherd life is a beautiful life. You just sit down in the forest and, yeah, get to know your mind. Just release into your nature. Okay, just leave a second left there. So this was at the height, shall we say, of the clan. They were about 22, I think, at that time.
Hi, Shepherd.
Hello, boss.
Chef Bella.
Chef, for the boss Bella. And everyone had a name on B, by the way. It was Balthazar, Bella, Beauty, Bandida, Brunos, which is brown cheese. yeah, it was many more names too. Baby Balthazar.
Okay.
So yes, now, finally. Liliana here is going to have a workshop later, and connected to that, she's going to offer you a little bit. So here's your word.
The thing is that if you are interested and you didn't have a first contact with DG5, we can provide you with your success code map for free during the festival. But I'm going to need your name, work data, and email is, I couldn't find the printer. I'm not going to be able to send the BG5 success code map. It usually is $10, not such a large amount. So, but if you want to get familiar to that and use it as a reference point to add something to react in case you are generated projectors or reflectors, I don't know. May be inspired by that. So if you feel like it and if it's correct for you, I think we are going to use Christo as he's very, very good in the accounting according to his pen activations to gather the data, and I'll try even if I have it in the morning to for it to be ready till the afternoon.
Darshana.
Hey everyone, it's kind of
cool to think about that we're moving into the corridor of civilization today, and we're talking about environment, which is sort of like substance as well. So the corridor of civilization is called purpose fulfilled through form. And our purpose is fulfilled through the form that we also occupy, the environment. So there's a nice little linking there. Rumi says, I am not this hair, I am not this skin, I am the soul that lives within. We are consciousness in form. But the form takes care of the consciousness. You know, we're hanging out here. And we don't get to be here unless we have the form, and we don't have the life that we really want to live unless we're living it where our specific design is meant to be. So we saw last time how you're supposed to eat right, right? In other words, and let me relanguage that, take in nourishment correctly in order to optimize your form's ability to differentiate, because we are predisposed to do that. And the correct environment provides us the same. These are my, I don't know whose notes those are. Anyway, it's the nodes on the design side that give us this understanding of what our environment is. The environment really affects us, you know, where we are. Because, I mean, here we are sitting in this room, and it's filled with different auras, different people's designs. We've also got the energetic of this land, of this location in the land, of the current transits that are going on. We're being conditioned all the time. And you learn a lot, you know, about, oh, conditioning, and that's the not self. But conditioning is life. So what we're here to do is to continually make decisions out of our truth, out of our true self, out of the energetics of our design as to what we're here to be and do. And then it doesn't matter where you are, because you'll end up in where you're going is correct for you. So usually what happens is we become homogenized by our environment. The energetics that we're sitting in are coming in, and we're sort of getting blurred. You're going to hear tonight with Viviana and Yuan also about the BG5, which we'll talk a bit about from what she was saying about the law and the penta. And that homogenizes us, you know. I mean, the minute you go into a relationship, you're homogenized. The minute you go into a group of five, suddenly it has its own, between three and five, it has its own design. And all of a sudden, that also is present, not only you and each other person's design, but the energetic of that grouping is influencing us. So you can see how where you are really matters. It really matters. Most of us do live a homogenized life. Oh, that's Randy in that picture. He was a good friend of Roz, and he passed on a couple years ago. Projector. He's dying children. Anyway, we end up often making decisions from the not-self when we're in a homogenized environment, because we don't distinguish. We don't actually feel the difference. We don't feel what is us and what is not us, which is why everyone in human design will always say the ultimate answer is strategy and authority. And that is because you get a strategy and you get an authority through your definition. That's what it comes from, or lack thereof, as in the case of reflectors. And then they have a monthly definition, a lunar. But the definition gives you consistency. The consistency, quote unquote, must be lived, because it's you. And when you're in a homogenized environment that's compromising you, which is not correct for you, then what you're using your energy on is the resistance in the environment. The correct environment is the one where you will thrive, you will live the longest, you know, because I think they've said that our bodies are actually genetically designed to live 110, 120, maybe a bit longer years. And then everything that we do that is off, you know, like you check off another year, check off another year. It's like, okay, now I'm down to 90 years. Oops. You smoke, or don't, or whatever is correct for you or not correct for you. Illnesses and these things just slowly remove the potential of this form to live a specific lifespan. So in the wrong environment, we're going to have a life full of resistance and a reduction of our lifespan. And it just won't be any fun. So these are the correct environments. And those are my notes there. So what we do when we're looking to see what kind of environment should you live in, we look at the design nodes, which are those funny little horseshoe-shaped images that you see in your chart over on the left side of the body graph. And so you can see there's two columns. There's the color in the middle, and then there's the left side and the right side. And as I was saying, with your way of taking in nourishment, the tones distinguish whether or not you're going to have the keynotes on the left or the keynotes on the right. If you have a tone, and that's that little triangle up there, that's 1, 2, or 3, you're a lefty. And what was it, Ewan, that you used? Like, left winger. and if they're on the right, well, actually that's a fit, wasn't it? then you're right oriented. So based on the charts that I was able to get from those of you who gave them to me, these are your environments, all right? And if there's some here who didn't manage to get me their designs, then you can ask me afterwards and I can look it up for you. Well, you're on there. Oh, that me. Now, where's my... Hold on just a sec. Because I actually, I have a lot more on here. Hold on. Right. Okay, enough distraction. Let's stay present. Sorry for my little spin in the moment. But anyway, so now there's more of you on here, and those of you who aren't. Kim, did you see I got you on there? I actually found your standard chart online, and then I, you know, you can make a chart if you know somebody. If you see a picture of someone's chart, you can actually build it backwards.
Yeah.
You start with Pluto.
Yeah.
So you find when Pluto was in those lines, in what year, and then from that, then you go into the month based on the sun, and then you have to adjust for the moon and the Mercury. It takes about 15 minutes, but when you're a projector like me, you do stuff like that. It's like, I want to see what's there. If you have somebody's chart but you don't have the data, and you want to put the chart in your program, like in order for me to be able to do some of the beneath the surface, like to have for Kim, I didn't have her chart, and she's external markets. And I was able to get that based on looking just at the chart itself and building it backwards. What's that called?
Reverse engineering.
Right. You know, like I do. Reverse engineer the chart. Okay. So what does all that mean? The nodes set the stage. The nodes are, you know, it's like where we're playing out our life. And so the gate that your node is in, the line that your node is in, on the design side, really tells you what the thematic is of the environment. Like I'm mountains, and I'm meant to be in mountains where there's certain things going on, where there's, I forget. Yeah, about team play. You know, like my second half of my life is the 19-4, fourth lines, networks, 19 gate of needs, meeting the needs of the people that I'm around with, and being sort of in a team, which when I read that, I was like, no, I don't want to be in teams, you know, because then I can't be myself and this and that. But that's actually the environment that I am going to be most useful in. So in human design, I work with the International School, I work with Human Design America in teams as an individual. So the nodes give us an understanding of where our design is meant to be lived out, what the gift of our design is in that environment that will be useful to that environment, correct for those who are occupying that environment, who are looking for a manifestor that can bring impact, or a projector who can bring guidance, or a generator who can help support with energy, or a reflector who will be able to show the, you know, reflect back what the health is and what the circumstances are. Oh, are a funny thing, because they're where the orbit of the moon around our Earth meet the orbit of the Earth around the sun. So you can see those two points there. And what's interesting about them is there's no planet. This is pure neutrino coming in from the sun and from deep space. So it's really our connection with the greater whole, you know, with the totality. It's really like the alignment of when we came in, we were oriented to live out that frequency, that spatial frequency or energetic structure within that. And the south nodes are the ones that look like a horseshoe that's lucky, you know, hanging upside down, trying to gather luck. And the north nodes are where we're pouring it out, pouring the luck out, pouring out the past, moving towards the future, building something that hasn't existed before with what we carry in from the past. Magnetic monopole is what is holding us to a specific path. So you can see this is like our journey. You see the past over there, the future here. And what that means is, like, the future is every second, right? Every breath you take is the next future moment. You know, you breathe it in, you breathe out, you breathe in, you breathe out. And our personality, sun and earth, our crystals, are moving down a path. And the magnetic monopole is attracting the life to us. And this is what we, this is where we get confused, you know, when we're thinking strategy and authority. And what we're doing is we're tuning to the frequency of the magnetic monopole as it pulls specificity to us, something very specific, your life, your imprint, your alignment with the totality. You're being moved by the magnetic monopole pulling you along. I experience that. I'm very sensation oriented. I like to feel things because I'm so splenic. And so I think of it like here is the magnetic monopole, and I think of it like a hook that's pulled in here, and then I'm just sort of being pulled along rather than I'm going. I'm being brought to my life. So you can see why if we get the mind in there, making decisions about, yeah, I'm not there, Darshana, come on, go over there, you know? And so then that movement gets disturbed, gets distorted, because I'm trying to, you know, be like his sheep and go over there when he's trying, you know, the magnetic monopole is trying to shepherd, is trying to bring us into our life. Ra actually called the nodes the shepherds of the moon, because the nodes are, tell us what our life is, the story of our life is going to be. This was a woman, I couldn't find her name, I forget who she was, but she was like a physicist. Huh?
Brain, she was a brain surgeon.
She was a brain surgeon. Yes. Very, very left oriented, very, you know, focused, logical, mental, very clear on a structured life. And then she had a massive stroke. And afterwards, she couldn't do anything she used to do. And her life, now she gives talks on TED Talks and things like that. She says here, at first I was shocked to find myself inside of a silent mind. But then I was immediately captivated by the magnificence of energy around me. You can hear the right orientation of this, this peripheral availability to what's present without any preference, without any selectivity. Left selects. Left goes, ah, ah. Right goes, ah, just available. And because I could no longer identify the boundaries of my body, I felt enormous and expansive. I felt one with all of the energy that was. And it was beautiful there. She lost her ability to do what she did before because of a stroke. And she found a world that hadn't existed to her before through the way that she saw the world and fell in love with it. So the moment that you're, as it says on here, the moment that your design node is correct, then the personality is correct. Our form correct, then this little awareness, consciousness, the personality crystal is going, whoa, check out this life. I wouldn't have thought of this. You know, because we're taken somewhere else. Our personality crystal has a different design imprint than our design crystal. Meaning that pointed in the correct direction. The passenger cannot be awakened if it does not see correctly. And to see correctly, you must be where you're meant to see. Our personality nodes express our particular perspective. Our particular. None of us are the same. Because we might have the same nodes, we might have the same substructure underneath the nodes, but we have different designs. And it's a holistic, energetic. Your design. So you look at the nodes and you can only see them filtered through the fullness of your entire design. You can't just select it out and make it about that, make a rule out of it. We are all designed to take in experience in different ways, and unless we are positioned correctly, we do not see what we are supposed to see. If we are incorrect, we express that which we are not supposed to be looking at. If you're not in the right place, you don't meet the people and the circumstances that you're meant to meet, pulled by your monocle, and then you don't see what you're meant to see, and then you don't have the possibility to express your uniqueness out through your outer authority, which is your personality sun earth, and in particular your personality sun, grounded in the earth. So you can see how like to really be this unique, differentiated being that's just wonderfully freaky and unusual, every single one of us. We really have to be aligned. And we are when we're born. We just get distracted away from it. The vehicle sets up everything. That's why we are when we're born, right? Because we don't have anything in the way. We don't have formed ideas, just mama, you know, food, warmth, comfort. What chance does the passenger have if the body is not correct? Well, what we get is the normal world. So they are the backdrop of our life, the road we travel. The road we travel, past to future, showing us themes that we are going to be molded by. And as you move down the road, you know, and when you change at your Uranus opposition from your south node influence to the north node influence, you don't leave either node. They're always present in your design. They're part of your design. But the emphasis in the first half of the life is on the south node, and the emphasis on the second half of the life is in the north. So you don't lose anything. You don't say, oh, now I'm in my north node. You go, now my emphasis is on the north node, but I carry with me my south node, because they're in opposition, they're connected. Yeah, that's just showing the ecliptic of the sun and then the earth going around, the moon going around the earth. So, environment, different colors. I've been going to one of these color festivals.
Yeah, holy, cool. Yeah, I have a lot of pictures like that. It's so crazy.
I know that they're so wonderful to use for this kind of looking at things because it really shows everything in different colors. So we want to know what is an environment. And we are now have been looking at where it is in the chart. Why do you want to know about an environment is what I've been saying. What are colors? What do they mean? What are tones? What do they mean? The body graph elements tell us what the correct environment is going to be. It's based on the color of the personality. The design knows. And the tone, which fixes it to the left or fixes it to the right. So that's the substructure. And then you look at the surface level, which is the gate and the line, and that's also interesting. So I'm mountains, but I'm not just any old mountain, right? I'm a fourth line mountain. Fourth line mountain. Sorry, I do talk fast, my apologies. And I have gate 33, for example, in the fourth line. So I'm a mountain 33-4, right? And so you already begin to get a sense of that there's all these layers of differentiation that you look at, which, you know, when you're newer at this work, it can just be overwhelming. So you just go one little step at a time. It's like, I can understand this today. Let's see. The rest of it, I'll work on that tomorrow. These are the four transformations. We're looking at number two today. We looked at the internal body and how we digest life. Have you guys been experimenting with your determination, your digestion, a little bit? I had an email from a woman the other day who wanted to have a reading on her PHS, and then she wrote back and said, okay, now I've already had one from somebody, and I don't think I want any more readings because I didn't agree with it. It was, I think it was saying she was mountains and that her determination was taste. And she goes, but I like to be on the shore with my yoga and different things she was saying. And this is the thing about when you get a reading or when you're doing your own understanding of this work, you don't want to literalize it. Don't take things literally. You have to understand the energetic that is involved. Ron called it deconstructing. He said, don't take these things literally. Understand them energetically. So we could say, what is a fourth line? We'll come to that. I mean, a four, and I have the fourth color, which is called mountain. What's a four? Networking, yeah, but narrow, fixed, right? If I'm in the mass, if I'm in the muck of it, right? The big, thriving humanity, do I have the ability to select my people and keep them near me? Or you know, if Christo was taking his sheep into a field of sheep, how would he be like, come on, guys, over here. I'm here, buddy. So the four has very specific needs and has a rigidity about it. So we could use this in environment like an integrity, a morality. It's a higher ground. For me, integrity is essential. The morality of it, the ability to have a little bit of distance so I can see if this is clean and healthy and spleen. Right? So you deconstruct it in this way. This is where we're dealing with others in our environment. And there's two kinds of environments. There's hardscape and landscape. The hardscape is man-made.
Man-made.
Or like a kitchen. I mean, you don't find kitchens in the nature, but you find valleys in nature, right? So kitchens, man-made. By, well, I mean, a cave is man-made in the sense that they turn it into a living environment. Yeah. We'll go through each one of them. But to just see that we're talking about lower trigram is man-made, upper trigram is landscape. And again, we think of our evolution as humans, you know, on the planet, and where we started, where we had to make in spaces in the environment where we were protected, where we could, you know, commune with the other, protect our children, feed ourselves, mate with the others, socialize with the others. The advantages for you inside of the correct environment, if we are objects of space, and we are anyway going to be meeting with resistance, we're navigating through, you know, I mean, just, it's funny when you think about air, it's like, well, there's nothing here. But when you said you really recognize that there's substance everywhere, we're in a substance, we're in a form world, and we're navigating through that. If we're fighting an environment or life that is resisting us, what is our energy, what is our vitality going to surviving the fight, right? So that's why we want to be able to thrive in the right environment, where we meet with the least amount of resistance. So you're protected if you're operating correctly and you don't have to deal with resistance. Unless, I mean, you know, never take anything like this as a rule, you know. Like, well, Darshana said we wouldn't have resistance, and I'm having resistance here. You know, maybe it's correct to meet that moment in that way as yourself, and the resistance is something that's correct for you, right? You know, so the point is not to use, to live in a life of, like, think of my poor husband, I always used him as an example. I mean, they're so amazing, these manifesting generators. I mean, whoa, you know, and I'm a projector. And he's, you know, like Krista was saying, you know, one step back. I mean, he's just boom, all the time, and then he bangs into something and he gets really frustrated, and then he gets angry. And it's because the energy, the movement was faster than the life was supporting. And so that's where then the manifesting, the MG has to take a step back and kind of Okay. Emotional authority, which is what he has in this particular case, would give him the time he needs to be clear where he can really move his energy. And might meet with resistance, you know, persistence of an MG, persistence of a generator. Yes.
Darshana, what's your viewpoint on the transference of the PHS, so from an environment? Do you have a viewpoint about there's a transference from your specific environment to its opposite on the actual?
Yeah, Ron said that we don't transfer on the design crystal side. What we do is because it's fixed, I mean, we're born, boom, here's the body. It has thisness. But the personality crystal is self-reflected consciousness. So you have a motivation and you can transfer it to the opposite because you can move, you know, because you can reflect it. So, well, I wonder if I tried that. But the body then is really influenced by what the mind is doing. And that's why you can't really have a healthy personality crystal if you aren't letting your body have its life. Because the body will take you where you're meant to be, in the environment, seeing what you're meant to see, engaging with the energetics that are there, not having resistance that's incorrect. Yeah, so there's no transference on the design side. So I don't transfer from mountain to cave. yeah, and I mean, we say thank God because we also can't even comprehend it, right? You know, because we don't do it.
I have noticed in a lot of cases that people have transfers, but not in the opposite, rather than, for example, from if the person is supposed to be privatized and closed, and then they do the open. But they're open and they do the closed, so similar.
Yeah, so it's not like you can't do it wrong, quote unquote wrong. It's not like your personality crystal can't go, well, I'm not doing that, I'm going to do this. Because I need it, I want it, I like it. But what we get from nourishment, from the determination, by eating correctly, we get the optimum nourishment, energetic, for our form, so that we can live in the most enhanced way and differentiate as our uniqueness. Doesn't mean you can't do whatever you want to do. You know, transfer, quote unquote, over to something else. So, I forget what I was talking with Ron, what was it you were saying here? He's hot. He likes to chew ice. And I was saying, well, maybe it's not the coldness of the ice, it's the crunching of it. You know, maybe it's the sound, maybe it's auric, maybe it's, well, we don't know. If strategy and authority is guiding you, that's why I will repeat, do not make rules out of this. First and foremost, strategy and authority. This brings understanding of why you notice that you prefer, like me, I prefer, from when I was in my early 20s, I would order a pizza. My favorite thing about pizza was the next day when it was out of the refrigerator, you know, when it was cold, not hot, because it burnt my mouth and all these problems. And I didn't know anything about PHS, but I was naturally drawn to it, naturally. Yes, Captain.
You feel different when you're on the mountain than when you're on the shore or in
the shore? Yeah, we'll look at that. That's a good question. And that's why I say you have to deconstruct it, because it's the aspect of mountain that we're looking at, not the literal. You're on a mountain from me. You're above me right now, right? My experience is by being here, I'm in my separateness, in my mountainness. I'm pulled away. Whenever we go to I sit on planes, I sit in theaters, wherever I go, I'm always at the edge, not in the thick of it, okay? So that's why I say if you want to deconstruct it, what happens when you're on a mountain? Right? And Rob, and we'll see that, Rob emphasized that it's got oxygen as well. You know, there's not as much oxygen. For me, if I deconstruct that, it's like there's not as much breath, there's not as much body heat, there's not as much closeness of aura. You know, I need my mountain where there's nobody around and I can just be me. That's where I'm thriving. I live in Denmark. There are no mountains in Denmark. It's one of the flatlands. But here's my justification. It's like, but it's way up there in latitude. You know, it's near the pole. But it's really about, you know, you have to live your life. I married a Dane, you know? And I'm more mountainy there than I was in California, living in the valley or at the coast. Because I'm further north, there's also fewer people, it's a smaller land, there's more overview, I'm not part of the system, I never participated in the system there. So that mountainness, you want to just deconstruct it and get a sense of what we're talking about. So let's get to them. And in the environment, you have communion with others without risk. What does that mean? That sounds weird. But it means there's less pull on you to be homogenized. There's more clarity. There's more support for your uniqueness. So here we go. Caves. A need, look down at the bottom, a need for an environment that is protected and secure. And this is about being selective about the other. This is about blending with the other and about having an active connection with the other. A passive connection. No, it's not a lot of stuff going on. What if we go back to early man caves, what happened? They lived in a world that was threatening, you know, there were dinosaurs or saber-toothed tigers or, you know, wild predators out there. And so they had the enclosure that they could go into and feel protected and safe. Thing about the three lower minds or environments, these are environments you go in and out of. We started about 20 past, so about 25 minutes. You guys are all out late at night, so you come in late in the morning, and then we start late, and then the whole schedule. So each person who has the next teaching doesn't know what they're supposed to be doing. So, and so I'll try and move it along. We'll be done at half past, okay? 25 minutes. Get through these. In caves, what happened inside of caves? It's where, again, we were safe, where we made our food, where we socialized. You know, you went out into the world, then you came back. And this is cave life. You go out into the world. You can have a cave, as you see there, inside your car. Like your containment, your holding environment, something that makes you feel held. And it can be selective and it can be blending. So you can see we've got a lot of cave folk here. Look at all of them. And the left is selective, so it's like, remember, left focuses. So they select, I'm here. That's why we've got the car. I'm selective of where I'm going to go out to the world, where I'm going to come back, who's going to be in my cave with me, in my car with me. And we have blending. I always like to use the example of my son. My son is a blending cave. And he lived in an apartment for a while with some other guys while he was going to school. And it was an old, you know, European apartment. So when you came in the door, there was these, what they call ensuite rooms. And then all the big rooms were occupied by boys because they had to be using all the rooms to pay the rent. So the first room that you would go into, my son was in. He's an emotional manifester, 5'1", blending caves. And then you had to go through his rooms to get to the next room, which the other boy lived in. And then there was another room over on the other side. While Nikki was living there, he started developing psoriasis and became very agitated and disturbed. When he lived with us, He's an only child. He had his own room, unless he wanted, you know, he was with us when he was younger. And but he always had his own room to go to, his own cave space. And the blending was important, but when there's two doors, he couldn't control the movement. The boy that needed to get to his other room would just walk through. And so the way we resolved it was we built up a partition so that the walkway was, you know, that there was a little freestanding wall, so that he had the sense of containment inside of his space, even though the others were still walking through, technically, his room to get to the other room. We still created the containment, and then his whole body, nervous system calmed down. He was able, his skin started getting better, he could focus better. So it can really make a difference, the energetics of the environment that you're in. This was where he would go back from being out in the hunt, right? You know, like if we think of cave people, they go out, they are in the world, that's okay, but they need to come back to containment, to a holding environment. So however that shows up for you, you don't want to make rules about it, you want to understand the dynamic of it. An environment where you have a sense of who's in and who's out. Right? Caves were tribal, you know? You didn't have strangers coming into your cave. I mean, if they did, you were really on guard. Any other questions about caves? All you cave folk?
Well, when you mean, let's say, when you have a block of apartments, there are 4% apartments,
I mean, you're not really in all the apartments, you know. It would be if you were living in a collective, for example.
Mm-hmm.
A collective, a house where a lot of people live in, a community.
No,
what I'm saying is that's what it would be. But, I mean, just because that's what it can be doesn't mean that's what yours is. You know, I mean, a blending cave might be, this is my cave, and sometimes I let people in. I'll have a party sometimes, and they have to call. It's a holding environment where you feel safe and protected. Okay?
That's the most important.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Selective left is focused. It's like I have this specific, like the car, this specific, and this person can come in. Whereas the cave of the dental office, for example, there's different people coming in and out. But it's still controlled.
So this is a blending cave.
This is a blending cave.
Yeah.
I mean, we could make an argument for this also being selective.
So if all
we're
of
all
you,
here for human design.
So if all of you left, I'd be in my cave, in my selective cave. Or if I walked out of the room by myself,
yeah.
I'd be in my selective cave.
Yeah, if you were in your room, that's
yeah.
Yeah, it's an environment where you feel safe and protective. Selective means there's a focus or a specific. Blending means it's just, you know, this life in my safe environment.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this could be blending,
yeah.
Because it's a lot of different beings from different lands, different languages, different designs. It can be selective. We all are here about human design.
Yeah.
So you could move it either way. So all you KDs are in the right place. Second environment, markets. Now this is evolution of mankind, right? We go from caves to coming out of the cave and going to where there is an exchange of commerce, an exchange. You have sheepskin, I have woodworking tools. You have potatoes, I have wood.
Potatoes.
Person who can fix your wheels on your carts. The cave was very limited. Immediate, family, close, closed tribe, but the market is where one clan meets another, where one tribe meets another. Markets represent this first step into social domain, and it's rooted in the enterprise, business, commercial, material. People with markets, who we got a bunch of people here. And if it's external, it's going to be more outdoors, more open, not so selective, remember? You know, when we had selective, it's focused. External means I'm in an outdoor market. And it might be indoors. You know, don't make rules out of this. Find the energetic, that's within the language. These are keynotes attempting to identify an energetic, not limiting. Internal markets. It's going to be more enclosed, more selective, more focused. I'm a shoemaker. I work with people who, you know, this is what this guy is. I work with people who come in and want shoes. That's our thematic, that's our shared market exchange. And then maybe they also sew, and so then I exchange with them. Our markets are exchanging, different exchange. So in today's society, and again, you can take these and put them in your computer life, you know. The internal markets could be, you know, working alone in your computer with other people, maybe one-on-one. External could be, again, working on the computer on a wider base, being out on social media, not being selective about what connects with you. Yeah, it was just, that's interesting, because I'm mountains, but I was thinking I'm very selective on social media. Like, I only put out so much, and a lot of times people are, you know, wanting to friend because my name's out there with the school and stuff. And then I always feel a little vulnerable about just accepting it. So then I use it in a very selective way, because I'm meant to be in a left environment. You know, so there's that narrowing down, right? Kitchens. Remember we were talking about hardscape. So again, and what's a kitchen? Does it mean you all have to sit around and eat all the time? What happens in kitchens?
Transformation.
I'm going to take this, and this, mix it together, put it in the oven, and wow, look what happened. I have a cake. Or something else. So the kitchen is an artificially changed environment. It's a hardscape. It's an environment where the temperature is changed. The wet sets the mutation in motion. The dry preserves it. Peripheral, right, dry. No specific, just holding it, being there available. Wet, left, water here, heat here, steam here. Focusing in, narrowing down. Left is a narrowing down, right is an opening up. Keep that in mind. Whenever you look at these things, you'll get confused by all the words, all the meanings. Right means a very wide openness with no preference. Left means I'm about that, and maybe that too. Right? You know, selecting, focusing. You get the keynote strategic on the left, and it sounds like, you know, not nice. It sounds like, you know, corporate greed or something like that. And it's not that, it's selecting. I am here, I'm into human design. I can, and the Jovian version, raw version of human design. I'm selective in that, I'm a focused mind. I cannot mix with all the other things. I get confused. I have to stay narrow. I can choose other things that don't have the same teaching or structure, modality. You know, like I study evolutionary astrology, it's completely different. They're like humans, but from different countries.
I get one question from the web. Does that relate to climate? For example, if somebody is wet in their environment, they live in a country or city which is the climate is very dry, but that they're completely.
Could be, so you might want to, you know, because it's a hardscape. I mean, again, this is something you go in and out of. So you might have in your apartment a wood fire. Or if you live here, it's everywhere. This is, you know, if you lived here and you were dry, then you might want to have a dehumidifier in your apartment or your house, you know, to help, because your breathing would be better. And your, you know, I mean, I really noticed that my breathing is affected here, you know, that I can feel the moisture in the air. So you can take literal like that, but again, you just want to first go into the feeling of it and see what supports a person whose environment is a transformational confined space that they'll go in and out of, that is either dry because steam and moisture is too activating, they need more space, or the moisture, the humidity, the heat and damp and that that comes with the wet. Well, that's why I put, for example, that up. I mean, there is a kitchen, a confined space of transformation, you know, of movement into joy, right? So we don't want to necessarily make it about a literal structure. We want to understand what the dynamic is of a kitchen and do it from that. Mountains. Mountains are about oxygen. The fourth color nobly feels good on the high ground because this is the place where they always have their advantage. The high ground is the place that's going to increase their well-being over the long term. The high ground, literally, metaphorically, intellectually, emotionally, however your body and your life is existing, take that higher ground if you're a mountain folk. Active means that you're an active participant in it. The left is always an active participant in the transformation and the kitchen and the this and the that. And the passive is in it, but it's just being present because the right is, the motivation of right is innocence. The agendaless agenda. I'm just here. I'm just, you know, and I'll move with my strategy and authority. It's not like I'm a lump on the wall. But I'm not like, what happens if I poke her, right? You know, that's left. It's like, ooh, let's go do that. Oh, manifestor, uh-oh. So the thing is that it's this, you're in environments that you're participating in without not actively changing them, whereas the left is in there doing stuff. You could take a mountain and make it into a building, up the first, you know, go upstairs. The place I'm in here, I'm sleeping on this up next floor from the ground. That's my mountain. If you're in a house with, you know, you only have ground level, well, what if the bed's raised from the floor? I mean, it's a baby mountain, right? You know, it's not on the floor. Yeah, that's fine. Valleys. Not many valleys here. We've got Alex, who's a reflector, and Andre, you're a projector, right?
Generator.
Okay. Anyway, valleys. When we go into the evolution of man again, what happens in a valley? Wide open space, but roads go through. It makes me think of like Marco Polo or, you know, the Silk Road or that sort of stuff, how they traveled from Europe all the way to China and exchange of tea and silk back in the day. And that there was this incredible possibility of exchange. In today's world, valleys might be metaphoric. Here we've got a coffee shop, a narrow valley. Or Reno, Nevada, which is rimmed by, I mean, it's actually only got mountains on one side. And desert on the other, but to be in the middle of a valley, an open space, it's wider. A lot of possibility for things going through. Valleys usually have rivers going through. So there's nourishment, there's, you know, resources available, and exchange. And then we come to the last one, which is shores.
I'm a natural shore by this, you know.
Shores is natural or artificial, as you can see here. The whole point about shores is being at the border of one thing and another. Right? Just like when you're on the roof as a six line, this is a six. You're not in it. You're up, you're apart, you're here, and you maybe have a foot on both sides. And you see that world, and you see that world. You're not of either. You are the role model, the six. You are the one who is capable of having the overview and seeing the movement to the next, which is what the sixth line does. It's aware of the transition to the next hexagram, right? You have an overview.
Horizon
would work, yeah. Usually shores are like that. I mean, you know, there might be cliffs right there or something, if you think of literal shores.
I'm not fine with this artificial shores. And she has an apartment, and she says, actually, in the living room, when I look through the window, there's not a block. And it's a border, and actually find myself sleeping in the living room, because in the bedroom, when I look from the window, and all of this kind of border, so she finds it very natural for her to be actually in the living room, there this kind of border is there.
So experiment with these. You know, experiment. Here it says the fundamental keynote of the six is transition. Shores, what is going to be healthy for these beings is a transition point. For example, seashore, transition between the boundaries of what the landscape is and the seascape. A transition, a place of change. The six is looking for the next place to go. So you have to be able to be there to see, where am I going to go next? Where am I going to step down into the world off my observation place, my removed place as a six, whatever point in the tripartite life you're in.
Can you say something about the natural or selfish?
Just natural is going to be more natural. And it's not necessarily nature natural, not necessarily. I think what, you know, artificial means, like man-made, like Central Park there, where you can see there's this and there's that, buildings in space. But what you want to do is just always stay connected to, it's that transition. You have to have the space. You can't be locked into the middle. You have to be in the transition point. Okay? That's where you're going to meet the people you're meant to meet, the ideas that you're meant to engage with, be able to provide your impact, be able to provide your guidance, or you're responding, or you're reflecting.
No, this place is just, I'm sure it's natural. And I just realized, you know, since the first day I came here, I'm like flying in this place, you know, like really high here. And it's the transition, it's not only the shore, it's the transition where the river meets the shore.
Think of it intellectually as well. Don't be in the middle of a deep teaching. You're on the shore of understanding this, you know, metaphysics and actual, you know, quantum physics or something, you know, like being on the shore. The environment that is representing the shore. Huh?
Gray area.
You could call it gray, yeah. But it's actually not grayed out. It's a this and a that.
Change.
It's transition.
Yeah, change.
So these are the lines of the nodes, just to indicate, I won't go through them, and you can look at them later, take pictures of them. Again, I'll give this as a booklet to bestow to provide to you guys. And here's the, this is on the line level. But always, when you're learning the numbers, wherever they show up, environment, motivation, determination. A four is a four. The quality of the four. The quality of the one. Yeah. Why is line four what? Because it's narrow, and if you don't have the environment that provides you with your specific network, it's just a lot of work to get people to take your way. Like Iwan was talking about working with Linda in the translation of the book. You know, it's a narrow field, and as a projector, you know, he could get exhausted going up against the narrowness. Or she might get exhausted with people wanting to move her always. Well, what about this? She's like, no, let's just talk here. Right? You know, I'm a four is a floor in the air, and it's work to be stabilized and up there. So you need to be in environments that are supportive of that, that are saying, yeah, yeah, it's okay, you can be narrow, you can be fixed, you can have your specific way, I'm not going to push you out of it. And if people do, you're going to get burnt out.
So when I'm like, what? It's good for me to be around people who are exhausted, but that's opportunities.
No, 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 this is what your environment is, around people who can become that as well, but aren't necessarily all fours. Just because you have that in your environment doesn't mean that everybody does. It means that's the quality of the field. But you also need to look at your gate. What's the gate? Where people are very fixed in tribal security, perhaps, or in collective leading, or in, you know, you have to look to see what is the gate, the theme of the gate, what is the circuitry, what is the center it's in, what is it, if it's unconscious. Huh? Yeah, anyway, we can't do more. I gotta stop. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
You're going to have the manifest workshop, so everyone's invited for like in half an hour, 45 minutes of talking about manifestors, and then we're going to only be the
I come and I